Starting in February 2022, GuoGu will teach a special Friday night class on From Indian Buddhism to Chinese Chan, Theories, Methods, and Developments. Register now at courses.tallahasseechan.org.
Comments. So we continue on comments on Song of Awakening, written by Yongjia, pre-modern Tang Dynasty, Chan practitioner. He was a very unique Chan practitioner because he was also a very well-read Buddhist scholar, you could say, Buddhist scholar. He wrote commentaries and so on. So he's written this long, discourse in poetic forms. That's what we're going on. So I'll read the passage that we're going to cover tonight, and then we'll proceed. So the text goes, in silence, it speaks. In speech, it is silent. This great gate of liberation is wide open without obstructions. If asked, what is this principle? This is simply the power of Maha Prajna, a great wisdom. That's what the it refers to in the beginning. Others cannot fathom if I'm right or wrong. Even devas, gods, cannot fathom whether I oppose or agree. I have practiced for many eons. What is said here are not some idle words that confuse and mystify. I chose this passage. We haven't been covering them literally line by line. We've been skipping. And this one is Sarah, is the audio popping? It's popping, right? Yeah. Okay. I chose this because talks about words, and we live in a time, a very unique period of time, in which there are many more proliferation of words politicized, infused with a lot of values, a lot of attachments. Am I the only one feeling this way? You know, there's a lot, certainly, I feel from my limited experience. I feel that there's a lot more words for things. And there's a lot, and it's coming from all fields, from slang to the medical field of labeling what they define as illness. Which in pre-modern periods, they may not have a word. It's just people are just, some people are just like that, right? I'm thinking of ADHD, right? People that can't, you know, attention deficit. It's a deficit. It's a lack, right? Whereas, you know, for example, kids, I think it's quite normal for kids to run around, can't pay attention. And it's quite, it's sad because they can take medication now. There's a lot more implication. There's a lot of things at stake. There's a whole industry behind it, fueling. And if you follow where the money is, it's not just words anymore. And people are growing up, develop it as they're growing up, for example, kids, as their brain is developing, they're infused and permeated and confronted with the option going forward in their life to reify and solidify their sense of identity as, in this case, deficit. Little kids, they grow up with this. Now we can put a name on it, we can label it. I have this disorder, I have that disorder. But that's only one example. But there's a lot of things out there, numerous ways of labeling, of using words and language, and being linguistic beings, comes with a price. Of being more reified, tethered, bound. Now there are more options to label ourselves. And old labels are being redefined and blurred, like pronouns, in which whole identities in this society are forming, reifying, solidifying. It has the implication of how they see themselves, how they want the world to see them. And the value that's placed on it, these words and language, the multiplicity, the proliferation of that, are leading to policies. And words are never neutral. They're always politicized. And then because the nature of words is to segregate, separate, other. That's the nature. That's the nature of words. It's to solidify, reify, define against something else. The nature of words is polarizing. Now, words can be quite useful. Or they can be injurious, inflict injuries. So what are we to do? Buddhist principle. We have to think in terms of cause and effect. In the middle of cause and effect, we have to consider conditions. Most people, they may not consider the effect. The choice of their word, how they want to be seen, heard, cared for, right? It come on a cause here. Effects are difficult to see sometimes. We can only see from our perspective. We don't know 20 years from now, 50 years from now, what's going to happen. We can't fathom it. We can't conjecture it. And we don't know how other people is going to take it. But just imagine a society in which everyone is using words in their own way, in a particular way. It's being politicized. And narratives are being built around it. What happens? Miscommunication happens. Further polarization. It's not just polarization. It has implications. Of taking sides. Taking stances. Fighting. And it's not words only, because words are the building blocks of narratives. And money is involved. Politics is involved. Industries are involved. So narratives becomes part of this problem of who gets to say the narrative, who controls the narratives, right? Who gets left out? There's layers and layers of this entangle. If everyone coming out from their own perspective, it just becomes proliferation. Yeah. I don't know how you all feel. Do you sympathize with this observation? There's so many words that I didn't understand growing up. There's a new term that's fashionable. It's called gaslighting. What's gaslighting? Right? What's gaslighting? Emotionally manipulating a person to make the person think that, maybe I was wrong all along. Maybe it's just because, what used to be, for example, communication. Right? We had that word, communicate. I tell you how you feel, you tell me how I feel. But then when someone tell you how they feel, like two people in argument tell you how they feel, you're gaslighting me. Gaslighting is not a good word. But actually, they just, of course, people can actively manipulate. Whenever there's two people, I want to say whenever there's two people, there's manipulation. Anyway. But we all know that even if there's one person in the world, that person will manipulate themselves. The vested interest in their own narrative about themselves. They can deceive themselves. We see that, right? So given that, you know, the reason I say this is because as a teacher, sometimes I give advice to students. What recently happened to me was I was called, I'm gaslighting, right? And the whole context is I was speaking with a person and not my student. They formed an opinion of me based on very little contact through Zoom. And I basically said, wow, it's pretty interesting. Well, how do you feel about that? I said, well, it's, I mean, usually, I said, well, usually I would suspend my judgment, and the judgment was so deterministic, it leaves no room for conversation. So I said, you know, it's all good. Everyone's entitled to have a view or something. Well, I want to know how you feel. I was like, well, actually, really, for me, to form an opinion about another person based on one contact, such a strong view, and it was a regular conversation. I said, I would not do that. Why? Because there's no real relationship. I would want to form a relationship, a real relationship in which there's an understanding. When there's no back and forth, so that was perceived as a challenge to this person's viewpoint. Which to me was like, well, you asked for it, so I said what? You know. Based on that, this person said I was gaslighting. Because I was making this other person questioning that. Well, perhaps it's not like that. You know?
Sounds like they were gaslighting you.
Well, I thought about it like this. In my mind, I thought about it was, here's a present presented to me. A present. How interesting. I don't want it. Here, you can have it back. You know, so I wasn't really offended or anything, but the deterministic, the fixity with which this person held on to that, show me that, wow, that's the extent to which those words, which are based on 20 minutes of regular conversation like this, it's a fantasy almost. Of course, hopefully this person won't watch this video or will never contact me. This, yeah, but it was that fixation. It's just this one-sided construct of this other person or the world. But now we have choices. We have the word, you know, gaslighting, not being present, not being vulnerable, So to this person, for me to be vulnerable would be, you're right, you know, I am that monster. Who is that? You know? Okay. It's just strangers. First time meeting. You know, fine, okay. It's all good. So, but now, the world is such that for this individual now has new vocabulary that helps her to construct a particular world in which this person can peg different experiences, people, to fit into that, compartmentalize that world. That, the extent to which, and the world, and there's another word called trauma, you know, trauma of all kinds. This is also relatively recent. In the particular usage of the word trauma, now I can say, for example, that interaction, hypothetically, that interaction was traumatizing to me. And you all would know what I'm talking about. Because we share the same repertoire of words. Now, if you're in 1970 or 50s, you wouldn't know, what? Where's the trauma? What trauma? Trauma meant something else back then. But the particular way that we are using it now has a particular valence, you see? So now you can label and other people in a particular way because that is the culprit who traumatized me. And my world now is constructed such that I'm not free. Why? Because if I do that, simultaneously, I victimize myself. I no longer have a choice. Because right now, that person's the culprit. I'm being traumatized. That's like, I'm the victim, you're the culprit. When something is outside yourself, how can you possibly change? Except I must change this person. Do you understand? I must change this person, change the world around me. I must find justice, which is another word. Particular usage in our time. This is injustice. From the Buddhist perspective, we're already free. But the way we frame things make us victims. Do you see that? It's just a new way of self-victimization. It's not to say that the world is just and there's no problem and we shouldn't have social progress and change and help the marginalized, help the subaltern, help those who are impoverished, help with the various types of gaps. Of course we should do that. But now we have more words of othering. It is could be useful to name things, therefore we can define it, which is, after all, that's what words does. Reify, solidify. Then we find a cure. But it's another way to skew. I may be criticized by speaking out like this. Skew a situation. That is, the problem originally is not there, but in the framing, it becomes a problem, and then now there's an enemy, culprit, and there's a victim. Do you see what I'm saying? That is why I chose this passage. I'm sure Yongjia in pre-modern medieval period has not thought about it in the way that I have framing it. But these teachings, they come to life in our lives and provide a new way, angle at the original intent, which is freedom. If you read this now, I'm going to reread it with that prelude that I gave before my comment. It's going to bring about another shift, another way to appreciate this, okay? Remember, it is Mahaprajna, liberation, right? Freedom. Each and every one of us are already free. And the whole Chan project, why does Chan or Zen define itself as a tradition, not dependent on words and language? Untethered. Why? Because it speaks from the position of freedom. Keep that in mind. Now I read this. In silence, it speaks substituted. You can substitute speaks with it's active, prevalent everywhere. But in speech, once you label, once you identify, once you reify, it is silent. First silence and the second silence is different. First speech and the second speech is different. This great gate of liberation, which is within all, it's all wide open, without obstruction. As Guo Gu would say it all the time, you're already free. If you ask what this is, what is the principle of this? It is simply the power of Mahaprajna. Wisdom that liberates. Others cannot fathom if I'm right or wrong. You can substitute the I with we, us, whatever pronoun you want, right? The key here is the fathoming. What is right? What is wrong? Can another possibly fathom that? In a context where everyone don't share the same language, sensibility, there are generation gaps, there are associations, upbringing, there are others cannot fathom if I'm right or wrong. Even devas, gods, cannot fathom whether I oppose or agree. Having practiced for many eons, what is said here are not idle words that confuse and mystify. So this interplay between silence and speech, labels and freedom, liberation and obstruction, self and others. Fathoming, which leads to right and wrong, right? Oppose or agree. And for practitioners, practicing for eons, right? For practitioners, how to navigate that? How to go forward in a world that stresses so much importance on words, labels, narratives. How to navigate confusion and what appears. Mystify, when I talk about some esoteric arts, something that we just don't understand. How to navigate that? That's the passage. And the key here is relationship. How and what kind of relationship do we want to cultivate? Being linguistic beings, what kind of relationship we want to build with words and labels, and by extension, discriminations and narratives. In the context of our practice. So the Chan position, Zen tradition, Song tradition, Tian tradition, various pronunciation of the original word Chan. Points out something so essential in what it is to be human. It points out the building blocks. Words and language. It's the building block to your sense of who you are, to your identity, to your gender, to your race, even the word race now. 100 years ago, it means very different than now. Every aspect of our humanity, what's the building block? If we don't get that relationship straightened out, we are bound to get lost in the sea, not lost, I should use the word drown in the sea of the proliferation of words and language and all that it manifests of this word. Yeah. And that relationship is at the core, yes, we are linguistic beings. But what Chan Zen points out is you're more than words. You're more than the narratives. Linguistic beings, yes, but words don't define you. You're already free. If we don't get that, we will continue to self-traumatize. There's potential for continual self-traumatization. With, I'm sure 50 years from now, we'll have new words. More refined, more politicized words to pigeonhole us and our experience and other people in a particular way. You can bet that's coming. Right? So if we don't get that relationship right, yes, we're linguistic beings, but do words really define me? Is it really true that I think, therefore, I am? I'm going to put Descartes here. I am because of the way I think. On the ultimate level, I should qualify that. What happens if you grow up in a particular environment in which your child rearing process, you're taught to think a particular way. Oh, you don't want that, do you? Because if you grow up thinking that this type of person is not good, or it's not even human, it's three-quarter human. Oh gosh, you think therefore you are. Do we really want to subscribe that much power to words? Words make lives. It creates meaning. Now, Chan Zen is not advocating meaninglessness of the word. If we continue to think, meaning creates positionality. Positionality creates stances. And we don't live in a bubble. We're living in a society, so it leads to policies. And it leads to, civil law. And in that context, criminals and victims. And so where is the humanity? Let's say even in criminals, the worst kind. What is it that it's shared between this person with two eyes, one nose, one mouth, body, two hands, with this one, with everyone? What is that person? What is this being? What is the potential? What is the nature? So in Chan Zen we say, all beings have Buddha nature. This was in the context, in the Buddhist doctrine of a different time, a different place, a different form of Buddhism in which certain Buddhist doctrines say not all beings have Buddha nature. Some beings are just impossible for liberation. Really? Did Buddhism say that? Yes. Why? Because Buddhism is made up of non-Buddhism. Paper is made up of non-paper. It's tethered to a particular time, particular space, particular shared paradigm. So Buddhism has evolved. Different forms of Buddhism have different valence of views and opinions. The values are different. The Buddhism is not a homogenized, all beings are already free. That's a particular type of Buddhism. Chan Zen, which is grounded in certain class of literature, scriptures, that's very different from some other corpus of text. Does that make sense? It's not agreed upon. So when Chan says that, in recognizing the freedom in all being, and identify that nature, human nature, the essence of it being a human, the humanity, as freedom, it's speaking against other forms of Buddhism that don't recognize that, which is tied to a particular civilization in a particular time, context. So even within Buddhism, there's new language. We spoke about invention of new words. That part is inevitable. what is shared is this possibility, this potential, what is shared for prajna, for wisdom. So because of that, the Buddha overthrew, historical Buddha, overthrew the caste system of the time. It's just that Chan calls it Buddha nature of those not used during the Buddha time, but they articulate it in another way. It overthrew caste system. It overthrew boundaries of gender. Women, stay home and cook. Rear children. You want to be a practitioner? A mendicant? No. But they overthrew that. Why is that? They may not have the word Buddha nature, but they have this possibility that's shared. Because the Buddha saw the constructedness of words and language, which creates cultures, values, meanings, constructs. That has its own trajectory. It just keeps on going. It's like a beast. Right? But that relationship to like what is actually here, as opposed to our overlay of culture, our overlay of what's actually here, our narrative, new words to pin things down, to pigeonhole, to reify. That's a whole other beast that's going down that has nothing to do with what is actually here. What is actually here is, in Chan's parlance, we're already free. If we don't get this relationship right, not in a doctrinal way, but in the way that we actually relate to ourselves, and we give rise to the suspicion of words. Now, all of our lives, no one is teaching us to suspect words. All of our lives, we've been taught to invest all of our energy, every aspect of our being, to words and language and narratives. And we're brainwashed because people keep on telling us we're this type of person, we're this type of person. For example, you may be growing up in a family in which your parents call you by a certain name, words. You grow up just feeling like that. Or your teachers tell you that. Or the society tell you that. Or the culture tell you that. The culture says, you, this color skin, back of the bus. Right? That's a way of telling you through words and language who you are. In that, confusion. What are we confusing? We're confusing what this is and our overlay of the culture. Oh, that's a floor. That's a good floor. That one is a bad floor. That's a bad. We're confusing reality with our overlay. Overlay continues to change. It's polarizing. It's samsara. We're confusing what we think it is with what actually it is. Right? Gotta get that relationship right. It's about relationship. It's about ourselves. It's about discovering our human nature. What is it? What is my true nature? There are various ways that Chan Zen points to this. It says, what is your original face? What is my original face? Or, before you were born, sometime that question, that koan, that's a koan. It's before your mother gave birth to you, what is your original face? mother need not be your literal mother. It could be the society. It could be every aspect of how you were reared, how you were defined, how you were pigeonholed, how you were labeled. We are the products. The mother is the producer. Who's producing me? Who's producing the values that I hold? Who's producing the meaning? Right. So the significance of this passage in silence, it speaks. This sentence, the silence is the freedom. In freedom, there's wisdom, prajna, it's everywhere. All beings already free. But when we put a label to it, when we name it, it's no longer free. In speech, it won't be again, it's silent. Right? That's why in the heart sutra, it says, no attainment, no wisdom. What? No wisdom? Because of no wisdom, there's wisdom. If you put a label on it, you're flawed. Why? Because wisdom. I have no wisdom yet. In that move, we self-victimize. We deny ourselves. I'm not awakened yet, but if I practice, I'm going to get it. Right? So even in that spiritual quest, it's wrong-headed. The beginning's wrong. You can bet the end is wrong. That's why the Heart Sutra posit this correct view, which is you're already free. Don't put a word on it. You put words on it, you focus on form, there's no emptiness there. When you let go, you're already there. The journey already complete. That is the great gate of liberation. Wide open, without boundaries, no obstructions. Where does the obstruction come from? The most obvious is words and language. I mean, you could technically say that's not an obstruction, that's an opportunity. You see the relationship? For example, the way my teacher trained me. Now, if we use contemporary 21st century words and language and value place, I can totally say, this guy's gaslighting me all the time. He publicly humiliates me. But the words I choose, the framing I choose is, he's pointing out exactly my self-referential attachment. And he's pointing to that freedom, yet I'm constantly, I need to be seen, I need to be heard, I need to be loved, I. This. Meanwhile, he's pointing, and sometimes he used the stick. Of course, in Chan, we call it stick of compassion. Right, that's the way we frame it. But I don't know if in contemporary times, you may get sued for it. One time, we're about to sit for interview. I'm his attendant. My job is to attend to him. He stepped on his robe in lifting himself up to sit like this. He stepped on the robe. Monk's robe is long. And because the seat was a platform high, no backing. He could have fell. He could have fell. I'm sitting down, he's sitting down. He stepped on his robe and he slipped and he fell, and I grabbed him. You know? And then he said to me, why didn't I make sure he didn't step on his robe? Is that gaslighting? It's my fault. No. Meanwhile, that word didn't exist yet. We're in the 90, 91? Did that word, that word was used already? Oh my goodness, I'm so lagging behind. I see. So, okay. So, I didn't name it that way. It wasn't as common. I didn't name it that way. What I named it was, what did I do? It's just, you know. And then, you know, of course, attendants, I have to frame this. Attendants, when they attend to their teacher, they usually, especially elderly, we do sometimes move the robe around. Right? But we were in a hurry, and they were, some people was gonna film us during the interview. That segment in which I was in my teacher's film, original face, do you all remember? There's a segment between I'm sitting down, I asked the teacher a question. It was that time. So the camera is being set up, and you know, so that's nothing compared to a lot of times. Now, the words and the framing could be opportunity, could be obstruction. Who is to say who's right and wrong? What is right? What is wrong? Everyone have their own perspective of what's right and wrong. Everyone. There's disagreements all the time, and there's misunderstanding all the time. And people don't remember things all the time. And they remember things differently all the time. Everyone comes out of, into the conversation that's ongoing from their own perspectives. It's not to say we can't move, we can't act now because we don't want to make sure, we want to make sure we don't hurt people. Hurting people is almost inevitable because, for example, in that conversation, that short 20-minute conversation that I talk about, the Zoom conversation, I thought it was pretty innocent. It was just introduction. But, you know, it's just what people bring to the picnic, all the dishes that they bring to the potluck, are so different, you know. Is there freedom in that? There is, but it really depends on our relationship with words. The extent to which people hold on to their narratives about themselves and about other people. If there's no freeing up about that, if there's no suspicion about that, if there's no self-reflexive challenge with which we relate to our own identities, which is another way of saying words and language, to ourselves, it's very difficult to practice liberation. Chan with the Dharma. Does that make sense? That's the fundamental, fundamental level. Fundamental. And hence, the koan method. You know, use poison against poison to challenge this self-referencing. And the immediate way we demonstrate, manifest self-referencing is words and language. In the way we think, in the way we feel. Even in the way develop self-consciousness about ourselves. It's based on words and language. It's through and through. So, that freedom needs to be found in that sincerely hope that all of us, everyone that watches this video, begin to examine the relationship that we have with words, with silence. Freedom and obstruction. Liberation versus insight. Confusion, mystery. Self, others, right, wrong. Oppose, agree. That's tonight's talk. Any questions? We want to know over time. I have to say that children, when we grow up, we need to learn words. It's like a catch-22. We need words, otherwise we'll grow up like we can't even speak, right? We need words, but then we also need to mature beyond the eloquent ways with which we can identify, classify all the things around us, including ourselves becoming an object for us to critique ourselves with words eloquently. We need to mature beyond that and to develop a transparency with which we see the workings of words and language. And where is that freedom within? So kids need right and wrong, good or bad. You can't start them young with like Chan view. I think they'll get in trouble. You know, they don't know what's good and bad, right and wrong. They'll get in trouble. So you need to rear that, and then you need to also begin to question that. You know? So lots to think about. Yeah. Not only think, because we're thinking with words and language. It's actually to develop a practice in which we can untether, unleash like a chain, like our sense of well-being is dependent on words and language and labels. For a lot of people, learn to unleash slowly, and to learn to be comfortable in ambiguities, in challenges, in misunderstandings, you know. And yet, sometimes what needs to be said has to be said, even though other people will bring their own dishes to the potluck and the picnic and define. Listen, they hear different things, but sometimes what needs to be said, needs to be said. You know, what we have to do is usually when we say something, we become that position. We become that position. So what we need to do is say something and see the reason why we do that and be able to be free. So I don't become my views. I'm much more than the views.